Hey guys, welcome to part two of a two-part series where I talk with you about EDS, the diagnostic process, and answer some of your basic questions. I'm not a doctor or any professional at all, I just have EDS, and I also currently am doing some research on classical EDS. Do you need to have a family history in order to be diagnosed with hypermobile EDS? No, you don't. A lot of people have EDS with no family history at all. Sometimes it's because they're the first mutation or they're just the first one that's badly enough to be affected to even seek out any sort of diagnosis. But there is a part on the hEDS diagnostic criteria where it asks about family history, but you don't need to pass it. But I didn't have a family history when I was diagnosed, and also I think so many people, probably most of them honestly don't, but that's just a guess. There's a lot of questions about the inheritance of EDS, so, you know, will my kids definitely have it? What are their chances? If I have it and I pass it on to my kids, will they definitely have the same type, and will it be as bad? So I'm gonna draw this out on my iPad, because I think that might be the best way to do this. You have two versions of every single gene, one from your mom, one from your dad. Now, a lot of the times they're, you know, just regular old genes, but every once in a while, one of them is mutated. So I'm going to put a finger up because this one is mutated. Does that make sense? So sometimes one of them is dominant over the other. For the most common types of EDS, it's inherited in a way that's called autosomal dominant, which means that if this gene is mutated, the mutated one is going to be expressed and not the normal one, unfortunately. So it kind of like masks this one, and then you basically just create a mutated version of, you know, the proteins that this gene is coding for. So you have EDS. Hopefully that makes sense. So we're gonna call this mutated version of the G uppercase E, and this one lowercase e. The uppercase E is, you know, standing for EDS. You probably remember in like the seventh grade when your teacher taught you about Punnett squares and biology. I don't know, maybe everybody didn't do that, but I did that. And you kind of were able to figure out what color eyes your kid might have. So let's say you have EDS, you have one mutated version of the gene and it's dominant. Remember, you've got this thing. So we're gonna, you know, notate that as uppercase E, lowercase e. Then let's say you have a kid with somebody who does not have EDS, so they just have lowercase e, lowercase e. You know, those are the two versions of the gene. Now we're gonna put this into a Punnett square to see what the four possibilities are for your kids. So you can see that there's a 50% chance that you're going to have a kid who has EDS and a 50% chance that you're gonna have a kid who does not have EDS. I totally wish I had clarified. Not all types of EDS are autosomal dominant. Some are inherited in a recessive manner, so this does not apply to those, but most people who have EDS have a type that's passed on in this autosomal dominant manner, which is why I chose this one. But we could always talk about the recessive type another time if you guys found this interesting. Now we can kind of apply this to another question, which is, if you have a type of EDS and you give it to your kid, will your kid necessarily have the same type of EDS? Yes, always. It's not a different type of EDS, it's the same mutation, you're not going to pass on a different one. Of course, there are going to be like rare circumstances where your kid might have some sort of spontaneous mutation, or you actually, you know, have a kid with somebody who also has a different type of EDS, which is very, very rare, but just throwing out some possibilities. Now, the other question is it ethical to have kids if you have EDS? Of course, that's completely your decision. And I don't think that it's unethical at all. It's completely your decision to have kids. Anybody can pass on anything to their children. And just because you have EDS does not mean you're gonna pass on your EDS to your kid. And it also does not mean that if they end up having EDS, that they're going to be affected even remotely as badly as you are. You know, sometimes, sure, sometimes worse, sometimes a lot better. It just kind of depends. But that's a decision for you to make and for no one else to influence. And I think genetic counseling might be something that's really helpful in this circumstance. Tips for subluxations and dislocations. So everybody's really different with EDS. I know some people don't dislocate or sublux often at all. They've only had a few events. And then some people literally sublux or dislocate something every single day. I'm somebody who kind of falls closer to the first one, but kind of in the middle as well. And so I'm not like the best person to give advice, but I will tell you some of the things that have helped me. So obviously bracing can be really helpful if you put a brace on something that's very unstable, though my doctors have told me that you don't want to keep something braced for too long because it can lead to some weakness of the muscles, which can be really bad, especially when you already have some level of instability in that joint. So my number one recommendation is to see a physical therapist or an orthopedist. But physical therapists are so good at figuring out, should you brace, should you not, what kind of brace could be the best, and then also combining bracing or something else with exercises that can help build up muscles where muscles need to be built up. So I'm just gonna give you an example. I dislocated my knee for the first time when I was 8, and it was really bad. It took a long time to recover. And after, I don't know how long, but I started PT a little while after once it healed a bit. And I was able to build up my muscle so much by doing PT literally every single day for probably at least 20 minutes in my house, to the point where it didn't sublux for like probably at least a year or two, and then it started subluxing again, but not that frequently. Whereas prior to my dislocation, my knee would sublux all the time. Like maybe, I don't know, I'm making this up, but maybe like 6 times a year. And when that happened, like I would be out of commission for like at least a day or two. You know, my knee would be messed up. Using KT tape can also be a good option. It's pretty stretchy, but then it has a point where after you stretch it, it no longer stretches. I don't really understand how it works, but it can kind of help keep in certain joints a little bit or just provide some extra support. I used to do this all the time for my patella. It wouldn't hold it in place, but it just provided a bit of extra support. Bracing, PT, and KT tape are some of the biggest things that have helped me. My cat will not stop screaming, so he's sitting here. Okay, now they're doing construction, so I think I might need to end this video before they start doing something else that's really crazy and annoying and loud. So thank you so much for joining me. Please let me know if you have any more questions, and I'd be happy to answer them down below. And also follow me on Instagram. I have a personal account and then also like a one kind of related to this channel. So go follow those, and I'll see you guys in the next video. Bye.